In the last video, we talked about how Saudi Arabia is transforming a huge swath of desert land into fertile soil and farmlands. So in this video, we will talk about one of the most valuable and important solid substances on Earth, sand. It may be little more than grains of weathered rock and can be found anywhere in the world, on beaches and deserts. But sand is also the world's most third consumed natural resource after air and water. Sand seems like an infinite resource, especially when you look at the Sahara Desert, the Middle East, and endless beaches around the world. We might be running out of this granular material, and the civil engineering community is very concerned about it. Surprisingly, even the desert countries like Saudi Arabia and the United Arab Emirates have shortages of sand and importing it from other countries. As a matter of fact, Burj Khalifa, the tallest building in the world, was built on concrete that was made of sand imported from Australia. Moreover, China has 27% desert area covered with dunes, but it's the top importer of sand in the world. The value of the sand business is $70 billion globally. So in this video, we will talk about why Middle Eastern countries are buying up huge amounts of sand, even though they have plenty in their backyard, and why the world could be running out of it. Wherever we go, we are surrounded by sand. It's in the floors beneath us, walls around us, and ceilings above us. Plus the sidewalks and roads we used to get from place to place. Sand is a key ingredient in concrete, asphalt, and glass. Not to mention the silicon chips inside our phones, TVs, and computers. It's the essential component of modern life as we know it, and it's the literal foundation of modern civilization. Thankfully, it's the most abundant thing on the planet, but we are using way more of it than ever before in human history. Sand is an essential element in producing concrete. Because of urbanization and construction boom in developing and even in developed countries, we are adding the equivalent of 8 New York cities to the world every single year. For the perspective, New York City is one of the biggest concrete jungles in the world. So China and India, which are leading a global construction boom, are one of the most voracious consumers of sand due to rapid economic growth. In just 2 years, from 2011 and 2013, China used more cement than the United States used in the entire 20th century. The amount we use every year is enough to construct a wall 27 meters high and 27 meters wide around the equator. So we are using sand so much that Middle Eastern countries like Saudi Arabia and the UAE are importing it from Australia and Scotland. In just 2014, the city of Dubai imported $456 million worth of sand. There are almost 3,500 Australian exporters doing business with the Middle East, with over 1,700 Australian sand companies exporting to the UAE alone. You might be asking, these are desert countries, why they just don't take it from the desert? Well, there are lots of types of sands, but generally aeolian and fluvial sand types. Aeolian is finer and smoother, but fluvial is generally more angular and what you want to use in construction. The actual shape of the grains of sand affects the strength of concrete. You want sharp, angular particles to form proper bonds, not smooth rounded. So you want sand particles that are hard rock as well. Certain sands can be comprised of soft rock, and these have poor qualities and can be broken down into smaller particles, which introduce slit into the mixture. Sand is just a range of particle sizes and does refer to the actual rock material that the sand is made up of. Generally, geotechnical fields refer to soils in four ranges of particle sizes. Gravel is the largest, then sand, slit, and clay. Aeolian, which is desert sand, has been eroded by wind rather than water, and it's way too smooth and basically a powder. If you will use desert sand to construct homes or skyscrapers, it will collapse in a matter of days. Fluvial sand that is used for construction has been eroded by water and is extracted from riverbeds, oceans, and beaches. Erosion by water results in coarser grains that bind together better. So this is one of the reasons why Middle Eastern countries are running out of sand. They don't have rivers and riverbeds, and they have already exhausted their marine sand supply. Imagine you work in one of those sand exporting companies and you put in your CV that you sell sand to Arab countries. It must be oddly satisfying. Because of huge real estate projects all around the world, the demand for sand has gotten so intense that it's causing problems. In some places, industrial sand has become so scarce that the industry has begun to attract organized crime. Sand mining is illegal in most countries, but sand extraction is riddled with corruption and scandals. For example, when you think of Mexico and South America and organized crime, what comes to mind are narco cartels, and those biggest cartels and mafia mainly control illegal drug production and distribution. But in Southeast Asia, the illegal commodity is not a drug, but sand. The mafia controls illegal sand mining and tries to sell to construction companies. In fact, the biggest mafia in India is the sand mafia. There are tens of thousands who make their living by illegally mining sand from rivers. They are so efficient that they steal industrial sand from beaches overnight. There are lots of violence, hundreds of people and journalists die every year in India for something as little as sand. Moreover, sand smuggling is very controversial in the geopolitical arena in Southeast Asia. For example, Singapore has become one of the largest importers of sand because they are expanding their territory. Singapore has increased its landmass by 20% in the last 40 years. The land reclamation is ongoing and it will need an additional 1.8 billion cubic meters of sand over the next 7 to 8 years for its plan to eventually increase its surface area by a total of 30% compared to its original size. Well, most of the sand used in Singapore was dredged from the beaches of Malaysia, Indonesia, and Vietnam. Due to the close proximity between Singapore and Indonesia, Indonesia is the main target to sand pirates. Because of it, Indonesia has lost a total of 24 islands, and other 84 low-lying islands are under threat to their existence, not to mention the disruption of the ecosystem of the region. Malaysia, Indonesia, and Vietnam all banned sand exports to Singapore in the 2000s. Indonesia thinks Singapore is in cahoots with sand pirates, which tremendously affecting the political relationship between these countries. The consequences of mining sand from riverbeds and beaches are very damaging. It decimates biodiversity, loss of land, changes to landscapes due to erosion, changes to hydrological function of rivers and ocean currents. For example, in China, sand extraction has caused a dramatic decline in the water levels of Poyang, the country's largest freshwater lake. If we want to prevent any further damage to ecosystems and people's lives, we need to reevaluate how much sand we are using and where it's coming from. It's not to say we are running out of sand anytime soon, but we will definitely hit the bottom as the number of developing countries is rising year by year and the demand is skyrocketing. Additionally, cement has to be heated to very high temperatures for clinker to form, and because of this, it's the source of about 8% of the world's carbon dioxide emissions. And if the cement industry were a country, it would be the third largest emitter in the world, behind China and the US. Concrete contributes more CO2 than the global aviation industry and is little behind than global agriculture business. As we human species are innovative, fortunately, there are several solutions. A group of 4 students from Imperial College of London has created a startup that focuses on making desert sand into industrial sand. The startup has developed a composite material named finite. It's sort of a glue and made from a desert sand and shares the same strength as housing bricks and residential concrete. Additionally, in comparison to concrete, it has less than half the carbon footprint due to the simple process of using organic binders and doesn't need extreme temperatures. Thanks to its material properties, finite can be easily reused and then remolded for multiple life cycle uses. Theoretically, finite could be used for permanent structures such as residential projects, but it's still in the testing phase. Further development of finite opens new opportunities to make use of desert sand and other abundant fine powders that traditionally have no use. If the testing and regulations of finite will be successful, it will be one of the most important, if not the most important, invention of the 21st century. Of course, even if this solution or producing alternatives in the quantities required to keep pace with global construction would be a huge hurdle. In part, any well-rounded solution is going to involve the same elements as any scarce management resource. We need to find ways to use less of it, use it efficiently, and in ways that will last longer. Thanks for watching, and huge thanks to everybody who's supporting on Patreon. If you like this video, please hit the like button and subscribe, and turn on the notification settings not to miss new episodes. Thank you.